Assalamu alaikum. Dear learners, I hope you are safe and sound. If you have followed all the video lectures in the series of instrumentation and measurements, then by now you should have developed understanding related to various systems involved in the whole process of acquiring the signal from the physical situation, protect it, and process it in a way so that it will be ready for transmission, and then ultimately route it to the required equation. Moreover, you must have also developed understanding of various concepts and terminologies associated with measurement systems and instruments. Up till now, whatever I have talked about measurement systems and related things is enough for at least a bachelor level engineer. Therefore, from now on, I'll be focusing on instruments only, that is, the sensors that are used for collection of physical phenomena. Hence, I'll be talking about different kind of sensors, how they sense a particular physical quantity, and how they are manufactured. Moreover, I'll also point towards the state of the art available around the globe for sensing a particular physical quantity. In this context, this lecture will cover a range of sensing technologies that are utilized for sensing physical quantities and based on which sensors are constructed. We will see in a bit that how a particular technology or method can be used to sense various kinds of physical phenomena. Sensing any physical phenomena requires a technology or a method that is affected by the physical phenomena which we want to measure. For example, to measure temperature, we can use any method that is affected by the change in temperature. Therefore, if the temperature changes, then that change will be translated into the change of the related technology or method, and then we can measure that change to establish the change in temperature. In this lecture, I will discuss a number of technologies that are used to measure a range of physical phenomena. So, let's start. The very first technology that I am going to discuss is of capacitance. A range of physical phenomena affect the capacitance of the two parallel metal plate capacitor. Hence, there are capacitive sensors that can measure those physical phenomena by keeping the track of this change in capacitance. Remember the relation of various physical properties of two metal plates with the capacitance between them from your physics course. It was something like this. In this formula, it is stated that the capacitance between two parallel metal plates is dependent on four different quantities, and these quantities are the absolute permittivity, the relative permittivity, the overlapping area of the two plates, and the distance between these two plates. More specifically, over here the permittivity of the dielectric is used. However, permittivity of various materials is represented as a product of absolute permittivity and relative permittivity. Relative permittivity is a term that relates the permittivity of any material with the permittivity of vacuum. Therefore, over here the absolute permittivity is the vacuum permittivity, and if you multiply it with the relative permittivity of any material, then this product will give you the permittivity of a particular material. Now just imagine that what physical phenomena can change these four variables. Because if these four variables are changed, the capacitance will change. A very easy and straightforward method to change the capacitance is to change the distance between the two plates. Now suppose that if one plate is fixed and the other plate is moving, then the amount of displacement of the moving plate will be directly related to the capacitance. Therefore, keeping track of the capacitance can give you the displacement of the moving plate, and hence you can use this arrangement as a displacement sensor. Moreover, this displacement can be changed by applying pressure or force on one of the plates, such that when pressure is applied, the plate moves towards the other plate. In this situation, the change in displacement is in fact related to the pressure or force being applied. This force may be applied by directly placing some weight on the plate or due to the acceleration of the whole setup. Or if the whole setup is sensitive enough, the force may also be applied by the crusts and troughs present in the sound waves. On the other side, what if we change the relative permittivity of the dielectric? That is, the material of the dielectric is changed. Changing the material completely is of course out of question, because you cannot open up the capacitor and change the material every time, and no physical phenomena can directly change the whole material. But what I meant over here is that the moisture content or the humidity value or even the liquid present between the two metal plates can change the dielectric. This change will change the relative permittivity value and hence the capacitance. A very famous arrangement of this kind of capacitive sensor is where two metal plates are inserted into the liquid and the level of the liquid will control the relative permittivity of the overall dielectric present between the plates. As the level of the liquid rises, the dielectric between the two plates changes because the liquid itself is acting as the dielectric, and ultimately the capacitance will change. This change in capacitance is related to the change in the level of the liquid. The next technology that I am going to talk about is once again a very familiar one, that is the resistance. There are numerous sensors that utilize the change in resistance of some material to a change in physical phenomena to detect that physical phenomena. The famous uses include the detection of temperature, displacement, force, acceleration, and moisture. In the upcoming lecture, we will see in detail that how resistance change can be used to measure all these physical phenomena. Over here, I won't be going into any more details of this thing. We can also use various quantities related to magnetism to detect a number of physical phenomena. For example, the inductance of a magnetic setup depends on the number of things present in the vicinity of the magnetic setup. Moreover, the change in reluctance and eddy currents are also sometimes used to detect proximity of various metallic objects. Examples of sensors based on magnetism are shown in these schematics. In this setup, the proximity of gear tooth will change the magnetic flux and hence the inductance of the coil will change. As the gear rotates, change of inductance may be recorded whenever the gear tooth passes near the pickup coil. Hence, angular velocity and displacement may be measured through this setup. The second schematic shows a similar kind of a sensor, but is for linear displacement or proximity only. The movement of the lower part will change the overall magnetic flux and hence the inductance. After this, let us talk a bit about some special materials that produce electric charge when a force is applied to them. The material is known as piezoelectric material, and the sensors that utilize these materials are known as piezoelectric sensors. The ability to generate a voltage in response to the applied force makes these materials ideal for sensing pressure, force, and acceleration. Sensing these quantities further allow us to transform the sensed quantity into other physical quantities. For example, acceleration may be transformed into displacement, and hence displacement sensing may be done using piezoelectric transducers. The sensitivity of these transducers can be understood by the fact that they are being frequently used for receiving ultrasonic waves. Because exposure to ultrasonic waves apply pressure on the piezoelectric material, which generate corresponding frequency of the electrical voltage. Mathematically, the output voltage generated by a rectangular block of a piezoelectric material may be expressed using this formula. Over here, V is the output voltage that a piezoelectric material will generate, F is the applied force, D is the thickness of the rectangular block of a piezoelectric material, A is the cross-sectional area, and K is the piezoelectric constant associated with a particular piezoelectric material. It can be easily seen from this formula that the applied force is directly proportional to the voltage generated by any piezoelectric material. Therefore, now it is the job of the remaining instrumentation setup that how a force is applied on the piezoelectric material. And once this force is applied, the piezoelectric material will generate a voltage. And if somehow we can read this voltage, we can know the applied force. Moreover, not only compressive force can generate voltages out of a piezoelectric material, but a force stretching the material will result in negative polarity voltage. Therefore, it can be readily identified that whether the force is tensile or compressive. The charge generated by these piezoelectric materials is not of a large magnitude. Therefore, the instruments which are used to measure the output voltage should have a very high input impedance. so that the small charge which is generated by these materials cannot leak and get consumed in the attached circuitry. And as the last thing, the piezoelectric principle is invertible. That is, if you apply force, they will generate a charge, and if you apply a charge, they will generate a force. Therefore, these materials can not only receive the ultrasounds, but are frequently used as a source of ultrasound. After this, let us talk about one of the most used sensors in industries around the globe. I'm talking about strain gauges. Strain gauges are, in fact, resistance transducers, which in their most basic form show a resistance change when force is applied. Specifically, strain gauges are used to detect very small displacements which occur because of the application of force. Almost all the weighing scales used nowadays make use of strain gauges to sense the force being applied on the weighing platform. The applied force will cause a displacement of the attached setup. This displacement will either stretch or compress the attached strain gauge. The stretching or compressing will change the resistance of the strain gauge, which is sensed by a suitable electric setup. Hence, the change in resistance can be mapped onto the applied force or onto the displacement. Over here, I am not talking about large displacements or large resistances change. Typically, strain gauges can measure displacement in a range of few micrometers, and the resistance change that I am talking about is in the order of few ohms only. Therefore, the attached electronic circuitry that measures this resistance change has to be very precise and sensitive. A typical term called the gauge factor represents the sensitivity of any strain gauge. It is nothing but the change in resistance divided by the change in strain or the strain applied. Therefore, a strain gauge of a higher gauge factor will show a large change in resistance for the same applied change in strain as compared to the strain gauge of lower gauge factor. Now, the idea is to increase this gauge factor so that we can easily measure the change in resistance. In the most basic form, a strain gauge is made out of a very thin resistance wire placed on a stretchable material. Over here, stretching doesn't mean that material may be stretched so much that it is visible through naked eye. Stretching involved over here is in the order of few micrometers or even smaller than that. Over here, you can see that if you stretch this material in the direction shown, then wires which are attached with this material are going to stretch as well. When these wires will stretch, the cross-sectional area of the wire is going to decrease and the length of the wire is going to increase. Both of these factors are going to increase the resistance of the wire. However, if the force is applied in this direction, then the change in cross-sectional area and the length will not be as much as to cause a change in resistance that is detectable. Therefore, mounting of strain gauges is a crucial matter that will dictate whether the strain gauge will detect the applied strain or not. You can easily see that increasing the number of wire loops in this type of strain gauge can increase the gauge factor. However, placement of wire in this form is quite difficult, and therefore we have produced metal foil type strain gauges. Now, instead of metal wires, we are going to use metal foil, which are much more easier to place in this fashion and hence can achieve a much higher gauge factor. It is not the only option to measure the strain using a wire or a metal foil. Piezo-resistive elements may also be used to measure the strain. Piezo-resistive materials are materials which change their resistance if force is applied to them. Therefore, strain gauges can also use piezo-resistive elements to measure the applied force. These type of strain gauges are called semiconductor type strain gauges, and they have a much higher gauge factor as compared to wire or metal foil strain gauges. However, these devices are much more expensive than the wire type or metal foil type strain gauges. Moreover, semiconductor materials or piezo-resistive materials that are used to make these type of strain gauges show a large change in resistance because of the change in temperature as compared to the metal or foil type strain gauge. Therefore, arrangement should be done to counter the effect of change in temperatures. Otherwise, a change in temperature will be taken as a change in strain, and you might think that a strain gauge has been stretched. A very serious problem associated with the use of strain gauges is that they have to be bonded on the object whose displacement is to be measured. And this is because of the fact that strain gauges will work if they are placed in the correct active direction. Otherwise, they will not show or capture the applied force. And as these wires or metal foil loops are quite thin, they are not capable of carrying high current. Therefore, the current level in any strain gauge is of the order of few milliamperes. If the current is quite low, and I have already talked about the resistance of these strain gauges, which is once again quite low, the voltage produced on the output terminal is therefore in the order of millivolts. These small voltages makes it compulsory to use various pre-processing methods to amplify the output voltage and reject the noise that is induced at such low level voltage signals. As I've already talked that piezo-resistive materials can be used for sensing the applied force, then you might have guessed that if anything can be used to sense the applied force, it can also be used to sense the pressure and acceleration as well. Therefore, there are sensors that utilize piezo-resistive elements to measure pressure and acceleration by monitoring the resistance of the piezo-resistive element. Let me clarify over here that piezo-resistive elements are not naturally occurring materials, but in fact, they are synthetically made by diffusing a P-type region into an N-type base. Therefore, these elements are semiconductor materials just like diodes. Piezo-resistive phenomena is also exhibited at a very small level in metal-type strain gauges. When a metal-type strain gauge is stretched, the change in resistance is because of the change in length and cross-sectional area of the wire. But approximately 10% change in resistance is because of the piezo-resistive nature of the wire as well. After this, let us talk about some ways in which light traveling between the transmitter and the receiver can be used to detect certain physical phenomena. It depends on the application that how the light from the transmitter reaches the receiver. In some cases, the light travels through the air, whereas in other, it is guided by the fiber optic cable from the transmitter to the receiver. No matter what type of transmission medium is used, it is completely immune towards electromagnetically induced noise, and hence it provides safety against various electrical issues which are normally associated with instruments. With these kind of sensors, the most used light source is the infrared LED, because it will receive the least amount of interference while traveling in the environment where visible light is in abundance. Although infrared LEDs are used as transmitters, photocells, phototransistors, and photodiodes are used as detectors of the infrared light emitted by the LED. Optical sensors are normally employed for detecting proximity, displacement, whether it is in translation or rotation, and sometimes for measuring gas concentration as well. We will study in detail that how optical sensors are used to measure these physical quantities when we talk about individual sensors in some later lectures. A couple of slides back, I said that the light generated by the optical transmitter may travel through the air or sometimes through the fiber optic cable as well. But the fiber optic cable can serve two purposes. In one form, it can act as a sensor itself, whereas in the other form, it can only be used to carry the signal from one location to the other location. The fiber optic is referred as an intrinsic sensor when it is acting as a sensor itself, whereas if it is only being used to route the light signal from one location to the other location, then it is referred to as being used as an extrinsic sensor. There are numerous factors associated with the construction of fiber optic cable and the light flowing inside the cable. If any physical phenomena can modify these factors, then we can easily measure that physical phenomena. The easiest parameter that can be modified is the intensity of the light that is moving inside a fiber optic cable. These schematics shows different ways in which the light intensity moving inside the fiber optic cable may be modified to sense a physical situation. For example, in the first one, an object may obstruct the light completely if it is pressed down. Therefore, this setup can be used to detect depressing of this shutter, and hence it is called a shutter switch. This shutter switch will give you either a 0 or a 1. 0 might mean that the switch has not been pressed and you will be receiving complete intensity of the light on the receiving side, whereas a 1 means the switch has been pressed and you are not receiving any light on the receiver side. In the second schematic, the position of the reflective surface will dictate the light intensity which will be received at the receiver end. The movement of the reflective surface will definitely influence the intensity of the light being received by the receiver, and hence the intensity of the light being received by the receiver can be related to the position of the reflective surface. The third schematic at the end shows how an optical micro switch works. It is quite similar to the shutter switch, but over here the fiber optic itself is moved away from the path of the light. And if that is the case, no light will be received at the receiver end. And if there is no force being applied on the fiber optic cable, then the light coming from the transmitter will move to the receiver unhindered. Other than these examples, there are numerous ways in which light intensity from the transmitter to the receiver may be modulated to detect physical phenomena. For example, displacement sensing, proximity sensing, pressure sensing, and even pH value or the concentration of the smoke present in the environment can also be sensed by changing the light intensity as it travels from the transmitter to the receiver through the fiber optic cable. Moreover, in certain setups, acceleration may also be measured by measuring the light intensity that is being received at the receiver. I will talk about these setups in more detail when I'll discuss particular kind of sensors. Over here, I'll just show you some schematics that how a particular physical phenomena may be sensed using a fiber optic cable. For example, in the first schematic, the applied force will definitely distort the physical structure of the fiber optic cable, and hence it will disrupt the connection between the input side and the output side. This disturbance will decrease the light intensity that is being received at the receiver. Therefore, you can easily map the applied force to the light intensity that is being received. Another way of sensing applied force using fiber optic cable is shown over here. The applied force will squeeze the fiber optic cable, hence reducing the light intensity that is being received at the receiver end. In this schematic, however, the proximity of the fiber optic cable with a particular reflective surface will dictate that how much light will be received at the receiver end. Hence, proximity sensing can be done using this kind of setup. Moreover, similar setup can also be used to establish the refractive index of any liquid. It can be seen over here that if the refractive index of a particular liquid changes, then it will reflect the light waves from the input side to the output side in a different manner. Therefore, you might not be able to receive the light at the receiver end if the refractive index of the liquid changes beyond a certain point. Furthermore, fiber optic cables can be used to detect temperature as well, using the fact that the refractive index of both the core and the cladding may change because of a temperature change. As the core and the cladding are made of different material, it will have different temperature coefficients, and hence their refractive index will change differently as the temperature changes. Furthermore, fiber optic cables may be used as an extrinsic sensor. That is, it may be used to route the light signal from one location to the other location. For example, radiations emitted by the engine may be routed through fiber optic cables to a remotely located radiation pyrometer. Now, the radiation pyrometer will detect the temperature of the engine, but the radiations are transmitted using fiber optic cables. Another example is a case where the internal temperature of the electrical transformer is measured using the radiations from inside that transformer. The radiation from inside the transformer are routed using fiber optic cables, which, because of their thin dimensions, are inserted into the transformer easily. The main advantages of using a fiber optic cable as a signal carrier for a signal generated by some conventional sensor is the protection it provides against noise. Any kind of electrical noise is automatically shielded out because the signal is not in the form of electrical current or voltage. Unfortunately, a huge number of conventional sensors are not generating signals which can be readily routed through the fiber optic cable. Therefore, you have to convert the voltage or current signal generated by some conventional sensors into a light signal so that it can be routed through the fiber optic cable. In such scenarios, piezoelectric sensors are quite useful because they can produce electric charge that can be used to power up a low power LED, and hence a light signal can be generated. Therefore, transmission of signal generated by piezoelectric sensors through a fiber optic cable is quite a convenient method. The last type of technology that I'm going to talk about specifically in this video is the use of nuclear radiations to measure some physical phenomena. Although nuclear sensors are quite uncommon, but they are still being used in highly sensitive applications. Because of the dangerous nature of nuclear radiations, there are strict safety regulations that limit the use of such sensors. Moreover, they are quite expensive as well. Using a very low level of radiations can take care of the hazardous effects these radiations might have on humans, but just like using a very low voltage signal, background radiations can easily corrupt these low level radiations. I'll just talk about a very reliable test that is performed on humans, unfortunately, with heart issues. It has different names, but the technical name is the nuclear stress test, in which a radioactive element is injected into the bloodstream and its radiations are captured through a suitable imaging device. If there is some kind of blockage in the blood flow, then the radioactive element will start accumulating at that point and the imaging will show an increased number of radiations coming out of that location. This will signal that there is some kind of blockage at that point. There are a number of radioactive elements that are used for performing this kind of test. These include thallium-201, cardiolite, or myoview. Cardiolite and myoview are proprietary names for elements known as technetium-99m cistamibi and technetium-99 tetrophosphamine. Over here, I would like to end this video. However, there are more sections to this lecture in which I will discuss a state-of-the-art temperature sensor made out of fiber optic cable and various sensors based on ultrasounds. Therefore, it is recommended that you view the referenced videos for discussion on these sensors. Thank you and take care.